All right, so look, this was a very big day concerning Roger Stone. His home in Florida wasn't the only one the FBI searched this morning. Agents also showed up at the Manhattan duplex that he shares with my next guest. Kristin Davis once testified before Mueller's grand jury. Welcome back to Primetime. Thank you. I know this is not what you want to be doing right now, but you want to support your friend. How concerned are you?
I mean, I'm concerned. They've obviously indicted him already, and he's been arrested. I'm also concerned because I watch CNN all day long, and everyone had an opinion, but nobody really knows Roger personally, and most of their opinions are based on their own agenda. So I think we should put some things in context.
Like?
I mean, first of all, Randy Credico, for example, there's
person
all these...
Person number two in the indictment.
Right, right. Person number two. We all know that. They're frenemies. They've had a horrible off-and-on relationship for 20-plus years. They threaten each other all the time, and then the next month they're going out to dinner. So a lot of these things are taken out of context. Randy Credico has personally threatened Stone on many occasions. They got into a fistfight in 2010 at one of my campaign events, instigated by Credico. So I think that people are seeing, oh, he threatened the dog. No, no, no. What he said was, I'm going to take your dog because Randy doesn't treat his dog well, and Stone's an animal advocate. So everyone wants to make him out to be this awful guy based on his public image, but that's just who he is as an
entity. You
don't
believe Roger ever intended to threaten him not to testify?
No, no. I think behind the scenes, Roger's telling him, tell the truth. And that's where you see him actually threatening him like, hey, you've sold your friends out. Why aren't you telling the truth? Why are you telling them that you're not the intermediary? I mean, quite frankly, I'm the one that, to my knowledge, that testified for the special counsel that Randy Credico was the intermediary. And then 2 weeks later, he was subpoenaed. So I've known this since 2016, since before it was even an issue.
Why do you think Roger went before the congressional committee in the first place? He could have pled the fifth.
I think he felt like it was his duty. I think like he felt like it was his duty. He's been destroyed in the press. He's been under constant surveillance, or at least he believes to be. And he thought that by going there and giving him his side, that it would somehow alleviate the pressure of everything that's going on.
You know, Rudy Giuliani talks about this idea of a perjury trap. Can't put the president in front of Mueller's guys. It's a perjury trap. A perjury trap is where they only bring you in to prove that you're lying because they have you already, not for legitimate investigative purposes. Now, I'm not saying that's what this was, but Roger had to know when he was sitting there that they were asking him such specific questions 2 and 3 times. Did you ever talk to this person? You sure you never talked to this person? You never talked to this person? And there was enough information in the questions that he had to know they had his communications. I don't get where his head was on that, do you?
Well, Roger Stone gets roughly 1,000 emails a day.
So you really think he might not recall?
I really think, as someone who's testified in front of the special counsel, I don't recall half of what they asked me. Mm. And it's a stressful setting. You don't have any attorney present. Your adrenaline's flowing, and you just sort of zone out. So you remember 50%. Mm-hmm. So could I remember everything they asked me? No. I personally wouldn't answer a question conclusively, yes or no, because that's not safe.
You were part of this. Not only did you speak to Mueller, but you got the FBI calling you early this morning. Also, a little bit of irony, it was an FBI guy that you'd been in contact with in the past about a case that you were part of. What was that about?
You know, the way it was presented to me, they called me at about 6:15 and they said, hey, we're at your door. Please get ready and make yourself presentable, and we have a search warrant to execute. And it was the officer that arrested me in 2013. And he said, I've been sent. I don't know anything about this, but I've been sent because, you know, I treated you kindly in the past and you have a young child. We want to treat you kindly now.
But didn't you move?
I moved. So there's no joint duplex anymore. So it's I've moved.
So did they search the right place?
Well, Roger Stone doesn't have a New York apartment anymore. So his
so
stuff is in
apartment.
Storage. No, they searched the remnants of the apartment that we had that's currently... being liquidated to storage.
Did you go to see what they would take?
No, no. I mean, most of the stuff is already out of there. It's already in a storage spot or being moved to a storage spot.
So you don't know what they got or whether there was anything to be had?
No, I don't particularly want to walk into a place where the FBI is. It's not my list of priorities.
Fair point. So here are the big questions. The two big questions I want your head on. First one will be easier for you. What is the chance that Roger Stone realizes these guys aren't messing around, this isn't a PR campaign, that this morning he got a taste of what kind of power these men and women have, And once his lawyers process what's in this indictment and see that this is a hard case he's facing, objectively, do you think he would cut a deal?
No. I mean, I think Roger Stone is one of the most resilient men I have ever met. He manages to take a horrible situation and turn it around, and I've seen it all the time, so I never doubt him anymore. So I would say that he's don't count him out. And I also think there's a lot of legitimacy in the fact he's a 66-year-old man and forgetful, and people should be entitled to understand that he's also a human being. And being in a stressful situation, even such as this, you forget, you don't say what you want to say, you are not articulate. And he testified in front of the Senate, I mean, by himself, no attorney present, for hours. I can't expect any normal person would remember everything they said.
Yeah, he was in front of that House committee, and that's what got him into trouble. One other thing, what your head is on this. The hard thing for me to accept is that Roger Stone, who has known the president longer than anybody involved in that campaign, has believed in him as a presidential contender longer than anybody ever has, maybe even including the president himself. He's going out of his way to do these things. He's taking efforts. He's all over the place. He's contacting all these different people. And the man he's doing it for has no idea. You find that hard to believe? That doesn't expose Roger Stone, by the way. I'm not talking about him and his exposure. Do you believe that he'd be doing all this stuff and that Trump would know nothing about it, or you think that's protective Roger Stone?
I think what we know of Trump as a president is that he does what he wants, when he wants, and he doesn't really answer to anyone. So I think that's probably how he also ran his campaign, is that, like Roger said, when Trump calls, he talks, and you listen, and maybe provide a little bit of advice, and that's how he is as a human being.
Roger has said, I will not bear false witness, but he can tell the truth, and you know the old expression. In this case, for certain, the truth may set him free in terms of what this case could mean to him. Kristin Davis, I appreciate your perspective once again on this matter. Thank you very much for joining.
Thanks, Chris.